And one of those things is to actually stop and ask yourself, can you make the clearance of the product? In other words, can you clear the shipment or not? Are you the right person? When we cover the general provisions, way it goes back to like class 1 or class 2, we discussed something called a notion of importer of record. And we established that all the legal responsibilities for the payment of duties, for the submission of paperwork, falls on that importer of record. It can be foreign person, it can be domestic person in the United States, it can be any person. But provided that the person has an interest in the merchandise and they are able to sign up and to meet the requirements for the paperwork. So this is, sometimes you may not be the right person, bless you. Sometimes you may not be the right person. And finding out when you are the right person. And if you are not the right person, can you go ahead and find an agent? And if you find an agent, who can that agent be? Is part of another prerequisite homework that you need to do before you take your stuff to customs. Because once you take it to customs and you submit all the paperwork, customs says, wait a minute, you can't be doing this. You are not the right party. And you say, why not? Well, you are the, it seems to me that you are nominal consignee. And nominal consignees cannot be the importer of record. So you have to go back and find that right party. So today, our discussion is going to be focused on that right person. It's a short discussion, but it's titled Right to Make an Entry. Who has a right to make that particular entry? So a lot of stuff about the right to make entry goes from that customs directive 35300002A. It should be attached to the file that I send you, and you should have access to that. It is also available on customs official website. It's kind of dense, and it has a lot of legalese. But as far as customs broker exam is concerned, customs has had tendency to focus on some provisions and to ignore the others. So let's take a look at those that customs decided to focus on. So we're mindful when we sit on the customs exam and we know how to give the correct answer. So the directive that I just showed, it identifies key parties. And those key parties have roles and responsibilities. And you must be mindful that a single party can play one role, more than one role. They can wear more than one hat. So a single party can be the exporter and the importer at the same time, for example. A same party can be importer of record and licensed customs broker, for example. As long as there is no conflict of interest, as long as all the requirements are met, that is okay. So let's take a look at this notion of making the entry. Well, first of all, notice the meaning of making an entry is tantamount to clearing the goods. So right to import equals right to clear customs means right to make entry. So it goes back to the same notion. Take the documents, go to customs. Can I do that? So if customs says no, go get out of here, you say no, customs, I have a right to make entry, and here is why. So you pull out that directive, and you show them you belong to one of those two categories. You either the owner or purchaser of goods, or you authorized licensed customs broker. Emphasis here is on authorized licensed customs broker, not just a licensed customs broker. Notice, only the importer of record or the party who is responsible for the payments of duties can file documents. licensed customs brokers can act as agents, or they can act as importers of record themselves. But it is only that party who can do that. And that simply means the person has a legal responsibility, and the person who can execute or can sign the documents that are entering the country. So let's look at the definition one more time. Owner or purchaser of goods. It comes down to the basic notion of, if you have a financial interest to the transaction other than interest as far as a shipping documents are concerned. So we've seen some examples where you have a notify party. And that notify party is merely, let's say, the freight forwarder. It comes to the warehouse and then it goes. That's it. That's the only interest in that person's product. That doesn't count. So the parties with the financial interest, they are listed here. There is a laundry list. As you can see, actual owner, the actual purchaser, buying selling agents, person or a firm. So we learned that what kind of persons or firms can be. That means limited liability company, such as corporation. It can be corporation. It can be partnerships. Partnerships can be either limited or general partnerships, or it can be sole proprietor or an individual. All of this is good. Because all of these are entities recognized, legally recognized, that can have a financial interest in a transaction. And it includes those who do those temporarily ones, like a trade fair exhibition, or those that do some specific work on a product so it is later exported, such as repair or alteration or further fabrication, again, for the purposes of export. So here, notice the intent is secondary. What you want to do with the product is secondary. The focus is on a person with a financial interest in a transaction. So if you can check mark this, then you're probably good. Next. The second party is listed is authorized licensed customs broker. Well, we know that we already discussed to have a license, you need to do what? You need to pass the exam, you need to have a good moral character, pass a background check, and be a United States citizen, not work for the US government. What else? Be 21 years of age or more. So licensed customs broker. So we know that the license is required, and you have to have that criteria. Your citizen, age requirement, citizenship requirement, and passing the customs broker exam. Authorized means pretty much two things. First thing is you have a authority from a client to represent, because this line item refers to an agency, right? You, a licensed customs broker, they can be the owner. If they are, they fit under this. So you don't worry about this one, right? They fit under this rubric, so you can forget about all those requirements. They don't even need a license if they are owner of the product. But if they're acting as an agent, they need to have a power of attorney, number one, from the actual owner, from the owner or purchaser of goods. And two, they need a permit. Permit from the port or from headquarters. So it can be either local or national. If it's local, it must be for that particular port where the product is entering the country. So if I have a New York, if I have a district permit for the New York, port of New York 1001, port code 1001, I can only do entries in New York. If I have national, I can do it anywhere in the country. I'm sitting in New York, but I can clear entries in Anchorage, Alaska, for example. So that's allowed. So This is pretty much what it means to be authorized. Those two things, power of attorney and permit. And of course, this is a general rule, and there are some exceptions. Not many, but there are some. This is the usual one, informal entry. $2,500 shipments, that is $2,500 or less. You can have a nominal consignee, which is usually the carrier, not a licensed customs broker, clear the product. Then you have immediate transportation, IT. So remember the situation where stuff arrives from Los Angeles and goes to Miami, inbound. It doesn't clear customs, it is still in the customs custody. But to bring it into the customs custody, you have to do a certain act. Usually that act means filing CBP form 7512. Once you file CBP form 7512, you can proceed with taking your stuff, putting it on a truck, and under bond, truck it to wherever you want to truck it, wherever you asked for permission to be trucked. The product is still within customs custody, you didn't pay duties yet. But once you arrive to the final destination, where you want to clear customs, this is when you start entering the stuff, which is when you start the customs clearance process. So, act of entering it for transportation, notice, without appraisement means you don't need to appraise the merchandise, because the merchandise, the appraisement means duties, and once you do the duties, you need to know the value, right? Well, that's not really necessary for IT purposes, because really what you are doing is postponing the time period and making a different change in the geographic location for the customs clearance. Shipment enter for transportation and exportation. So this is another example where you have stuff coming into the one port of the country, let's say Los Angeles, and then it goes to Tijuana on a truck. Tijuana is the northernmost borderline town in Mexico. So from Los Angeles to Mexico, how many hours it takes? Maybe 4 hours, 5 hours of driving. So you put it on a truck, you take it out of the country. You don't even need to. The final destination was Mexico in the first place. So do you need to be a licensed customs broker for that? No. Why? Well, because a lot of things that licensed customs brokers do, it deals with customs clearance. Most of this customs clearance is done for the purposes of consuming product, to bring it into the country and do something with it. This is merely transportation, another relay point, and we learned about that in part 18, 19 CFR. This one is also in part 18. This one we haven't talked much, but we discussed it because this is kind of not much money to bother, not too much money to worry. Then it is allowed. The second one concerns friends and relatives. So sometimes you may have a friend who may be experienced but not licensed. Sometimes you may have you may send a product to, let's say, your parents in the United States, and you live outside of the United States, and your parents would like to receive it, let's say, but they would like to clear it, right? But let's say this is not theirs, because you send it to someone you do not know, but you sending it through the parents, or you sending it through the friend. So they are not owners of goods as such. They're just helping you out because they are physically located in a country and they don't mind driving over to customs office and asking customs officer to clear the product. Situations like that do happen, especially in close communities where one member of a community tries to help another member of community who is not necessarily a friend or a relative of the person to whom the goods are destined, but he is a friend or a relative of the person who sends the product. So you can do that, but there is a restriction. And the restriction is it must be occasional. Occasional meaning you cannot make a business operation based on a friend or a relative. Because if you could, guess what that would do? That would mean that you could bypass the licensed customs requirement. That means you wouldn't need to have a license. You just merely sign up as a person's friend. You will not find definition of friend in this outline. And there is a reason for that. Because it's friend depends on eye of a beholder. Friend pretty much means any person who is not your enemy. If you listen to, I think, Mr. Barack Obama, when he talks about some countries that are friends and some countries that are not friends. So really it's kind of obscure word. So it's limited. So to use this means to limit this to occasional, and occasional is defined. Occasional means it's a single one-time deal. It's not for commercial purposes. So let's say I asked my grandma to send me some herbs from Europe because my teacher was sick. And my grandma sent some for my teacher, right? But I'm a friend, this is one-time deal. But those are very expensive. Notice there is no price limit, right? So it can go above, it can be $5,000, right? But it's single, it's not commercial, because I'm not making it for the commercial, pretty much means for profit. I want to sell it and make more money. That's the bottom line. And I'm not getting paid. And I think by getting paid, what they really mean is a shallow notion of getting paid, just pulling out dollar bills and or transferring transactions.